Jadi dia masuk seperti Betul. Tiket itu sendiri lepas tu nanti accommodation dia yang tanggunglah, malahnya nanti sampai airport dia akan apa, dia akan ambil
kita
tak mencari dia nama kita. Jadi ikut je dia, ikut saja dia, ikut je dia masuk ke hotel, hotel check in, check in dia. Hotel, hotel dia, semua dia yang urus. Hotel tu
memang ada.
Hotel tu seperti yang dalam apa inform itu, dia sharing. Tapi tak tahu sharing dengan siapa. Mungkin sharing dengan different nationality. Kalau apa, Nazia satu perempuan saja kan. Malahnya maybe sharing dengan orang lain. Tapi dalam registrasi form tu, minta bilik yang segera.
Dia sengaja kecil lah.
Nanti the difference you will pay your tanya aja berapa difference.
Buku tu punya topografi.
Yes.
Buku kat sini saya nak buat.
Yes.
Bukan untuk buat formal.
Dia kena buat kod baru dia tak boleh tukar.
Yes. Balik kita 23 November dengan Malaysia tadi. Tiga bulan awal saya sudah 28 Fatimah atau Faifa 24 24 tu apa minta untuk ada blog. Mau Faifa. Ada 3-4 kali blog Faifa. Nanti near to the day, dia akan bagi yang lebih detail. Situ akan dia masukkan nama, dan dia akan minta kita berhubung tajuk apa kita nak beri. Yes. Ya, itu project saya sangat lama. Itu usually it's around the topic of your interest. Not necessary. Boleh tempatan tu apa planning, boleh result, boleh apa pun ada, boleh just fikiran saja apa yang idea apa nak share tu boleh. Tapi dah dari saja, tak lagi. Tak ada apa tu. Just apa lebih satu planning tentang apa nak research nak mana. Boleh juga.
Saya tidak tahu. 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 Saya tidak tahu Oh, okay, no, this
Di sini, 20 km dari sini. Anak-anak mau tes masuk sekolah.
Then we come to the meeting. Yes. That is the method. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Vice Chancellor of Perdana University to give a welcoming remark. Apologies for the delay. I was informed that he was stuck with the traffic somewhere. He should be here soon. May I ask all of you to come very closer to the front part of the room, filling the chairs in the front row.
Thank you. Because the friend, Research base, especially in the world of healthcare. And in that context, we certainly welcome this workshop on bioethics, bioethics training course. Certainly, good research, writing, and publication culture must begin with and must be based on ethics for doing those things. And I look forward to a good conversation on these topics. And I was told that there will be more coming in as we go along. And I take this opportunity to say thank you very much again, and to welcome you to Perdana University and to this workshop. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the book for opening officially the today's workshop. We will have various activities during these 3 days. But before we start with the first keynote speech from Professor Pat Morgan, there is a housekeeping message from the channel from Azlan.
Assalamualaikum, good morning. I think first of all we should thank Perdana University for giving us the place to be here. Just a few things about this coming workshop. You know, this workshop is actually the extension of the 2013 workshop. During the 2013 workshop, we done it in AUSN, Kementerian, and our group work have able to publish 4 case study, which is published in our USM Medical Education Journal. If you want to, it is an online journal, so you can go to website USM, and there will be a link on the Medical Education Journal. So we have on the patient refusal, on medication, refusal on operation, and decision making. So it's a case study, but on ethical discussion of the ethical dilemma. So we hope that this workshop also can bring about at least few publications as well. But this time we do not say which journal you have published. It's up to you, but at least we can guide along how to write a case study, but on ethical dilemma or ethical decision on that sort. So that will be the group work. So basically, we'll be having a concurrent session during the group work. If you go to the timetable, the group work manuscript writing is for those in healthcare and master's and PhD degree lectures and defense. Will be chaired by Dr. The places after the talk, then we will bring you to the nearest breakout room. Okay? And the only additional is that please after lunch at 2 p.m. Please come back here first because we have a representative from the National Professor Council Malaysia from Dr. Zubaidi. And we would like to have some words and to have the things on this ethics teaching in medical and healthcare. Okay? So come here first, and then after that we go on with the book take up room again. Okay? And the others, that means the first group work will be in a group. I'll be finalizing the participants and maybe you pick up into 2 groups for the manuscript writing. And we will start on discussing the potential case to be discussed and make a publication. We have facilitators who have involved in ethics teaching. Amalia, the World Group on UNSWIT Indonesia, will be helping out. There will be the AUSN team, and Dr. Tebo from the WBA also with us. Okay, so we'll be taking out to the discussion. hopefully with that we can have publication, and the publication is not just mainly for the KTI of the university and whatnot, but also to help out the ethics teaching as general. For example, the four publications that we have produced from the previous workshop, we are now using it as our teaching aids for our undergraduate medical study, where our students can read through the case and know how to discuss ethics, and that will be the teaching aids for their PBL discussion. And when we publish it, then we can share with the others, and so it's very good thing. So we hope that we can achieve that also. Maybe if not ready for these 2.5 days, maybe we can work out from email to finalize the thing. That's what we did previously. Okay, so we hope with that our networking will be more, and we can learn and share with each other. It's basically the whole idea. Okay. So I think go back to the
from Adam for outlining brief what we have to achieve during this teaching workshop. We had our first keynote on psychological perspectives on non-modeling, which will be delivered by Associate Professor Dr. Karen Morgan from Perdana University. She's a lead in psychology with a specialty in health.
Conditioned response or salivation. Now we see classical conditioning everywhere, and it's very prevalent in healthcare. Things like anticipatory nausea in patients who come for chemotherapy. Patients will say that they begin to feel nauseous the minute they come into the car park of the hospital. And this is the body having the reaction to the chemotherapy that's going to happen in a little bit. For the dentist, dentists aren't that popular. Many people sit in the waiting room and they hear the drill next door and they begin to cringe. And this is classical conditioning. We associate the noise of the drill with the pain of maybe having a dental procedure. Taking medication for a headache. People have headache and they take two paracetamol or two ibuprofen and they say instantly, oh, I feel better already. When in fact, the medication couldn't have taken effect already, but its body is speeding up the physiological reaction because it knows what's going to happen. So in a way, this is kind of related to the placebo effect. And advertisers exploit classical conditioning all the time. They pair things they want us to buy with things we want to be. So if you want to be lovely and sociable like this lady, you would serve Pepsi at your parties. More doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarettes, so clearly Camels must be superior cigarettes. If you're going to be a smoker, you should smoke Camel cigarettes. It's very exploited by Marxian people. Operant conditioning, which is probably more of concern for us, is voluntary actions. And this is behaviours that are controlled by consequences. These two people in the bottom corner here, B.F. Skinner and J.B. Watson, dominated psychology for much of the 1900s, the behaviourist thinking. Skinner really held that there was nothing you couldn't teach anyone to do. You could teach anybody to do anything if you worked hard enough at controlling the consequences of the behaviour. Watson went further. He's clear that if you get him a dozen healthy infants, well-formed, and his own specified world to bring them up in, he could guarantee where you weaken a response by if I park on double yellow lines and I get clamped, theoretically, I'm not going to park on those double yellow lines again. Punishment doesn't work nearly as well for changing behaviour. In fact, it's not that effective at all. Probably the best way to look at the two different types of conditioning is to take the example of substance abuse. So if you have somebody who takes heroin, the initial purpose of taking heroin is to get the buzz or the rush from heroin. That is a very classic positive reinforcement. But what happens very quickly with something like heroin use is, rather than taking heroin to get the rush or buzz, people take it to stop the really bad withdrawal symptoms from heroin, and that's classic negative reinforcement. So they're trying to remove the withdrawal. And then we have classical conditioning going on because a lot of addicts would say that when they start to assemble all the paraphernalia that they need to take heroin, they automatically feel that sense of relief because they know they're going to be injecting the drug. And that's classical conditioning. The paraphernalia has become the conditioned stimulus. In the 60s then, it wasn't until the 60s that Alfred Bandura kind of went up against Skinner a bit. He said, no, hang on a second, it can't possibly be that we have to have these complicated reinforcement cycles in order to learn things. And he said, learning occurs in a social context. It's not rats in boxes or pigeons in boxes. People are in a social environment and they learn from watching others. And he said, you know, it really wouldn't make sense. It wouldn't be very safe for us to always have to learn things on our own. We need to be able to watch other people doing things and say, well, that's a good thing to do, or that's not such a good thing to do. And what Bandura wanted to do was he wanted to test some of the dominant thinking at the time. In the 60s, it was kind of the start of TV, and people were beginning to get TVs into their houses. And the dominant thinking at the time was that if you watched somebody behaving aggressively, that was actually you were less likely to be aggressive yourself if you watched somebody else be aggressive. And Bandura wanted to challenge this, and he did this in some very important experiments called the Bobo Doll experiments.
Watson had shown that emotions are learned.
Can you all hear that?
And Harlow that we are intensely social creatures. So it was natural to put these two ideas together and ask, how much of what we do and feel is learned from other people? In 1961, American psychologist Albert Bandura set out to see how far just watching other people influences our behavior. Bandura chose to study aggression. At the time, the widespread view was that watching violence reduces aggression. It urges us. But was this true? To find out, Bandura experimented on small children, aged 3 to 5.
What Bandura did is he put an adult in a room with a child and a bunch of toys, including something he called the Virgo doll, which is a giant inflatable doll. Then, what happened after about a minute, the adult unexpectedly started beating up the doll in a really quite vicious manner, shouting, screaming, kicking, hitting with a hammer, and went on like this for about 10 minutes.
What would the child do if after watching the adult, they were left in a room on their own with the same toys?
She really is going for it. She saw the adult do. She's lifted the doll up, and now she's really hammering it. She's got a little hammer out, she's having good experience now. She shows innovation, if nothing else.
Every child who watched the adult being violent copied much of what they'd seen. The closest imitation was when a child observed an adult of the same sex.
Now he's got a gun out and he's using that, a combination of the gun and the hammer, to just whack the doll. He's got a very aggressive expression on his face.
Importantly, another group who had watched an adult play gently played calmly, showing no signs of aggression. Basically, what the children saw, the children did. This was an utterly unexpected finding.
Before Bandura did this experiment, psychologists thought that seeing somebody else acting out a violent scene would be cathartic and sort of purge you. But what this clearly demonstrated and really shocked people at the time is that actually what happens when you see something doing violent actions, you tend to imitate.
Bandura's findings were given added impact by his timing. His experiment took place just as television was moving into the home. 2 years later, Bandura re-ran his experiment with one important difference. This time, he wanted to compare how children react to watching an aggressive adult, not in real life, but on film. Children watched two versions. One was a straightforward recording of the adult beating up the Bobo doll. The second, a fantasy version, with the attacking adult dressed as a cat. In almost every case, Bandura got the same results. Children imitated what they'd seen. The results were dynamite. This was one of the first experiments to look at the impact of television violence. The complicated relationship between TV and behavior is still being debated. But it was Bandura who opened the floodgates and launched an entirely new area of research.
So Bandura launched what's called social learning theory, which is the theory of learning and personality. And he challenged Skinner's assertion that thoughts are not important. He said that clearly is not the case. Bandura believed in what's called reciprocal determinism, and that's just a fancy way of saying that Bandura thought that personality, cognitive factors, or how we think, behavior, and the environment are all influencing each other all the time, and we can't take one component away from all of the others and try to understand individuals. He said observation learning was key because it really expanded the range of stimuli through which children and adults can learn every day. Interestingly, in neuroscience, there's a lot of work going on at the moment looking at what are called mirror neurons. So quite by accident, in the late 1990s, a group of researchers noticed when they were studying monkeys that when one monkey would perform an action, another monkey who was alongside him would have activity in the prefrontal area of the brain, very specific activity. It only occurred when the other monkey performed an action. So they identified a network of what they called neuroneurons. They were actually able to pinpoint very specific neurons. So one reached out and grabbed a peanut, another neuron if they actually ate that peanut. And in the very late 90s, using PET scanning, researchers identified a similar network of neurons in humans. They haven't identified specific neurons, and it's an area of a lot of controversy at the moment. And some people argue that these neurons might explain things like empathy, why people, why we can put ourselves in other people's shoes, and why we might wince when we see somebody else experience pain. Some people suggest they might even be implicated in autism, infantile autism, because children with autism often have a problem with social connection and empathy, and perhaps these particular neurons are implicated. But as I say, it's an area of a lot of controversy at the moment. So observational learning then is clearly important. And Bandura argued that there's four things that need to happen for people to truly learn from observation. They need to have time to attend to what's going on. They need to be able to remember it. They need to be able to translate that memory into action. And they need to be motivated to behave in that way. So this is important in terms of when we're trying to demonstrate skills for students or trying to teach them particular ways of doing things, that they have time for attention, to remember, to encode, to translate into action, and be motivated to actually behave in that way. And what Bandura found is that there are different categories of people that we are more likely to imitate. So we're more likely to imitate people we see being rewarded for behavior. So going back to operant conditioning, if we see somebody getting a reward for behaving in a certain way, we're more likely to behave in that way because we also want that reward. And that might be good or bad. We're more likely to imitate warm and nurturing people. We're also more likely to imitate people who have control over us. And again, this could be good or bad, and it's very important for students who are often in a relationship of unequals. People who are similar to us, so this is kind of peer pressure or social pressure from peers. People we perceive as being of higher social status, so this is closely aligned with obedience or doing what a superior might tell you. When we lack confidence, we're more likely to do what somebody else does, and equally when we're in ambiguous or unfamiliar situations. So if we don't know what we're doing, so if you're a new houseman in the hospital, and you don't know what to do, you're likely to copy what you see somebody around you doing. And if we've been rewarded for our behaviour in the past, we're more likely to do it. So if the wrong reward or our reward is wrongly associated with behaviour, it's hard to break that reinforcement. So this really brings us on a bit to group influences on behavior, because all the people around us are influencing our behavior. And there's a couple of things that are important for us to think about in terms of professional behavior and being ethical when it comes to group behavior. The first of these is groupthink. Groupthink usually occurs when a group has been together for a long time and it's the same members of the group. And it's where the group decide that harmony within the group is more important than decision making. So the group will often make very bad decisions because they prioritize the harmony of the group. So there are some examples of this in healthcare. For example, the Bristol case. Is anyone familiar with the Bristol case from the UK? The Bristol case in the UK occurred in the 1990s in the Bristol Royal Infirmary. They had a very high rate of death following pediatric cardiac surgery. And after some years, there was an investigation, and the investigation concluded that there was severe lack of leadership, there was a kind of an old boys club, there was a very lax approach to safety, and that the group, kind of a group thing situation, had prioritized attracting government funding for research over the health and the lives of the children that were being operated on. Group shift happens when people move to a more extreme position in a group, and this happens very often. So if you think of gangs, or if you think of kind of like gang mentality, People feel more comfortable in being more extreme in their views when they're in a group. And people will do things in groups that they won't do as individuals. And that's because there's safety in the group. It's a kind of a diffusion of responsibility. So groups will make much more risky decisions than individuals. De-individuation is where people lose their identity completely in groups. And then two that are really important, I think, in healthcare are conformity and obedience. And conformity is yielding to either real or imagined pressure, and obedience is obeying an authority figure. If we look at conformity first, conformity was investigated in the 1950s in a series of experiments by Solomon Ash. He started a study in which he advertised for male undergraduate students to come and take part in a study on visual perception. And there would be seven people in the room. What the participants didn't know was that six of them were actually Confederates. They were working with the experimenter. So he would put them all seated around the table. The first five would be Confederates, then the participants, and then you would have another Confederate. And so what the participants were asked to do in the experiment, they were asked to look at the line on the left and to say which line this matched on the right. So the answer to this one is clearly C. So what would happen then is, on the first two rounds of the table, everyone, the Confederates would give the right answer. But by the third round, the Confederates would start to give the wrong answers. So they'd start, each of the five of them, and say A, 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 A. So this confused, obviously, the participants, because they're thinking, what's going on? And what happened over the course of the trial was that participants started to change their answers. They started to give the answer that the Confederates were giving. And that happened in up to 3/4 of cases, at least once in the experiments. And when asked why the participants did this in debriefing, they said it was kind of fear of being ridiculed. They really wanted to be liked by the group, and they kind of assumed that the group must know more than they did, that there must be something going on, they must be missing something, and that's why they were getting the answer wrong. The Ash experiments have been repeated quite a lot, and always similar results. And I just want to play you a clip of a very recent run of a twist on the Ash experiments, in which this lady goes into an optician's for an appointment. She doesn't realize that the waiting room is full of Confederates. And what's interesting about this is it shows how she quickly conforms, but not only that, how she takes her new rule, the new social norm, and she brings it to a totally new group, unsuspecting.
To answer that question, we set up a hidden camera experiment to see if this woman would stand up at the sound of this tone, simply because everyone else is. You might be thinking you'd never go along with this. Or would you? After just 3 weeks, and without knowing why she's doing it, this woman is now conforming perfectly to the group. But what happens if we take the group away?
Elaine, please.
Gone and nobody is watching her except our hidden cameras. What do you think she'll do? She's now conforming to the rules of the group without being there. Now, watch what happens when we introduce another outsider. She'll teach the new guy what to do. We kept the camera. is a random rule for this woman has now become the social norm for everyone in this waiting room. Here to explain what's going on in their brains is Jonah Berger of the University of Pennsylvania.
This sort of internalized form of curvating is part of what we call social learning. Starting at a very early age, we see members of our group perform a task. Our brains literally reward us for following in their footsteps.
When I saw everybody stand up, I felt like I needed to join them. Otherwise, I'm like excluded. Once I decided to go with it, then I felt much more comfortable.
Conformity is how we become socialized, but it can also cause us to develop bad habits and repeat past wrongs.
And it's why even this rebel, who wasn't standing for any of this nonsense, eventually joined the ranks. And the only thing more shocking than seeing how easily conformity affects the way you act is that similar forces are subconsciously shaping the way you think right now.
So, I mean, it's funny but also scary at the same time because it shows how strong our sense of wanting to be part of the group is and how quickly we conform in situations and particularly if we're in a weaker position or we're more junior in a situation. So conformity in healthcare is really important. And not speaking out when there is a problem is a problem. Whistleblowing has a long history of being associated with huge personal loss for people who blow the whistle on different things. So it was an anaesthetist who blew the whistle on the Bristol case, Stephen Balson, and he met with huge amount of resistance. He was really told he needed to be quiet and it was not the way you carry on. And eventually he had to move to Australia to get a job because he could not get a job in the UK in the immediate aftermath of what happened in Bristol. Of course, we have cases in Ireland too. We have a very famous case of Dr. Michael Neary, who is an obstetrician, who carried out 129 of 188 peripartum hysterectomies in the hospital when most obstetricians would carry out 10 to a dozen in their lives. And actually, it was a junior, it was a midwifery student who actually drew attention to this eventually when it came out. So that's conformity. Another area that's really important to look at and affects us in healthcare is obedience. And obedience is where people follow commands directly, usually from somebody that's in authority or has authority or control over them. And remember, we're more likely to copy or imitate people who are in control over us. This was looked at systematically in a very important experiment carried out by Stanley Milgram in the 60s and the 70s. Milgram was really interested in the Nuremberg trials, and in the response given by the Nazis who were tried, he said, "But I was only obeying orders. I didn't mean to cause these atrocities. I was doing what I was told to do by my superior, and I'm a soldier, and I have to do what I'm told to do by my superiors." And Milgram was interested in seeing how far ordinary people would go if they were given an order to behave in a certain way. So what he did was he placed an ad in a newspaper looking for people to take part in a study on learning and memory, and he offered some compensation for that. And so two participants, but actually one was working with Milgram, would come into the room and he'd say, "Right, I'm going to sign you at random, one to be the learner and one to be the teacher." But the participant always ended up being the teacher. So the learner was then taken into a room and in front of the teacher was strapped to a chair which had electrodes and was clearly connected to a machine that could give shock. So you have a scenario like in the picture here. You have the experimenter, the scientist, white coat, looking very serious at the table in the back, the teacher who's the participant, and the experimenter or student who's in fact the confederate or working with the experimenter. So the teacher was given a set of word pairs to teach to the learner. So the teacher would read out the list to the learner, and then they would read back one word from the pair and give them four possible answers for the other words. And the learner was to press a button to indicate which word it is. If there was an incorrect answer, the teacher was to deliver a shock. And that shock would go up in 15-volt increments, up to a fatal dose, potentially, with every answer the learner got wrong. Now, of course, in the experiment, the learners got a lot of the answers wrong. And what happened after a few wrong answers was the student or the learner started to bang on the wall and to ask the teacher to stop the experiment. Some of them said, I've got a heart condition, you must stop the experiment. And then after several times of banging, there would be complete silence from the other side of the wall. So the implication being that something very serious has happened. If during part of this, the teacher stopped and looked to the experimenter behind them, the experimenter would simply say, you must continue with the experiment, this is very important for science, you are not responsible for what happens. So in most cases, people continued. In fact, up to 65 to 70% of people continued right through to the end of the experiment, knowing they could have potentially killed the person on the far side of the wall. Milgram did various variations on this experiment, one where he got the experimenter to leave the room. People were much more likely. It dropped to about 20% of people who went through with the experiment if the experimenter wasn't in the room. So clearly the effect of the experimenter is really quite important here. And there was a really good BBC Horizon recreation of this experiment recently with almost exactly the same results. It was based in the UK with professionals from various different backgrounds, and about 65% of people continued right through to the end, even knowing that they might have killed somebody on the far side of the wall. I think this is really important for education and for the way we work in structures where we have hierarchies. Students will do something that somebody they perceive in a power. And they may not question it or may not feel they can question it. So looking then at role modeling in medicine, there are various and different definitions. In simple terms, it's really looking at people we can identify with, people who have qualities we would like to have, or who are in positions we would like to reach. More so, it's really faculty members demonstrating clinical skills, modeling, articulating expert thought processes, and having professional characteristics that we follow. Role modeling happens on all levels of curriculum, in the formal curriculum, so structured classes, etc., in the informal curriculum, and that's in math, and in the hidden curriculum, which is basically the underlying ethos of the whole program. Role modeling is not mentoring. Mentoring is a formal relationship in which there are clear groups to follow. Role modeling is much more elusive. It's much harder to pin down, and people who are role models might not even know that they are role models for students. So there's no general standard or formula. But we do know that up to 90% of students identify at least one role model by the time they graduate medical school. So they are important. If we look at the best evidence in medical and health education about role modeling by doctors in medical education, a recent review identified 39 studies. These were of varying quality, but most of them of medium to high quality, which looked at this whole area. And the authors came up with six main themes, the first of these being the attributes of positive doctor role models. And there were three categories of attributes. The first were clinical skills. So good role models have excellent clinical skills, but more importantly, they have a patient-centered approach, and they demonstrate empathy, respect, and compassion in the medical environment. This is really important. In terms of teaching skills, good role models have good teaching skills, but what's really important is they establish rapport with the learners, and they're interested in the learners, and they're interactive with the learners. And then in terms of personal attributes, they're positive people. They're enthusiastic about what they're doing. They're committed to excellence and a high level of integrity as rated by the students. The second theme was about personality. So the personality of positive role models. They're described in various studies as being conscientious, as striving, as being dutiful but assertive, as being trustworthy and cooperative, and they have good coping skills. So they're a good person to go to in a crisis because they know what to do, or if they don't know what to do, they have a calm approach to the situation. The third one was really important, and that's the influence of positive role models in student career choices. Oftentimes, clinical tutors do not realize how much of an influence they have on shaping what students want to do as a specialty. And that's something that comes through a lot in studies of role modeling. The fourth theme was the process of positive doctor role modeling. And this goes back to what Bandura said about the four stages of observational learning. In the process of positive role modeling, there's an observation phase, there's a reflection phase, and then a reinforcement. So being allowed to see what happens, being allowed to think about that and translate it into your own actions, and then reinforce it by either trying it out or by discussing it. The fifth was the influence of negative doctor role modeling, and this was really important. Studies in which people talked about being specifically put off certain specialities by having a negative interaction with the role model. And things that were highlighted were derogatory humour, hierarchy, exclusivity for gender issues, and senior staff criticising institutions that everybody was part of. And the final theme was the importance of culture, diversity and gender. This came out a lot in studies with multicultural samples. So people gravitate towards role models that come from similar backgrounds as them, relate to them, and that they might be able to achieve the things they've achieved because they come from similar backgrounds. Females, particularly in surgery, like to have strong female role models that they can relate to. So, in conclusion then, I suppose, looking at how we might improve role modelling in medicine and in healthcare in general, we need to raise awareness among faculty so that faculty are conscious that they're role modelling when interacting with learners. That students are watching you and they are, you know, attending to you, they're observing what you're doing, they're reflecting on what you're doing, and this is really important. And we need to make role modelling more explicit. So whether it's in the clinical skills unit or it's on the wards, that we acknowledge what the process of observational learning is and we allow time for that to happen. That we develop programs which specifically look at role modelling, professional and clinical behaviour. And this really comes down to the assessment of professionalism. So Gothberg famously said that really all we do in most medical schools when we assess professionalism is we assess how obedient students are. So we're assessing how much they obey our rules and regulations. And this is a bit of a dilemma, because we want our students to obey our rules and regulations, but we also want them to be critically thinking. We also want them to ask questions, and we don't want them to unnecessarily conform to everything they see out in the world where we're not there to help them. So how we assess professionalism and ethical behaviour is really important. We need to train teachers and learners in self-reflexive practice. So how to reflect on what you've seen and how to consolidate that learning. And finally, I think it's really important that we recognise good role models. So who in Perdana University or any other university would we regard as a good role model? And how can faculty learn from those good role models? What is it they do that we could learn from and to give them some recognition? So I'll leave you with two quotes. Are about observational learning, and I'm happy to answer any questions anybody might have.
They are in a position or a situation where something is going wrong or they don't like, instead of being a group, group think, why not group shift? And what happens to the group and why they choose to be or group?
Group think usually sets in when a group has been together for a very long time. Mm-hmm. It's one of the reasons why we tend to change groups so you tend to change some of the membership. It's why we have two-year terms on executive committees, or you have a limit of the amount of time somebody can be on a committee, because group think tends to only set in after a certain amount of time, and it becomes a very kind of dysfunctional way of thinking. The group are not open to any outside ideas. They don't want any outside ideas. They want to do things the way they've always done them, whether that's right or wrong. So it's usually a question of time.
And group shift?
Group shift is usually where there is a decision to be made. So for example, let's just take the American election as an example, right? You might have your opinions about Trump or about Clinton. If you're in a group that feel a certain way, you will feel more empowered to say maybe stronger things than you would say as an individual, because you're kind of protected by the people around you. Everybody's saying it, so it's okay to say it. So we tend to kind of go towards more extremes where we have the comfort of the group around us, because it's kind of we can't be held accountable for it ourselves. The group is accountable. And that's why groups make riskier decisions, because the individuals feel it safer. I mean, cult learning is more about obedience and conformity. You have a very strong authority figure who influences people, and then when people come into the group, there's a strong social norm, and people conform to that. And it's very hard to break that conformity.
Yeah, I was interested in regards to the other theme of paper writing, because people tend to repeat the same arguments. For example, there's a common sentence: bioethics started in 1970 with Van Rieser Potter, 1970, but as you know, it's Fritz Jahr in 1927, so this has become the new mantra. And the same with the quotations of four principles approach from each of the children's. But actually, you have this from much earlier authors as well. So people group think in a sense in their writing style. And
it's accepting something that's written without maybe checking the original. Yeah. And things get distorted. So a bit like the clip about the group norm, the way that lady took the norm from one group and then she perpetuated to another group, and potentially each one of those people could perpetuate that. And it's a totally meaningless social norm, but it gets perpetuated, and I think that happens in writing all the time.
And also we can think about oath as well, because people just took this for 2,500 years, they try to go, it's good, but actually with the contents, it wasn't necessarily what they were doing.
Doing things just because, but that's what she said in the clip. She said, well, everyone else is doing it, so I thought I should.
Thank you very much. Sorry, I think probably, I'm sure there will be a lot of questions. That is a very interesting presentation from Prof. Morgan. But I'm sure she will have more time during the break or throughout the sessions in the workshop if you'd like to have a discussion with her. I should thank again Prof. Karen Morgan for one presentation. There is one token of appreciation from the organizer. I should call upon Prof. Zabi to give it. Yep.
Thank you, Phil. That was a very nice talk. Very welcome.
We have a short time of break now, probably about 5 or 10 minutes before we go to the next session. We will have a more formal session here. Yeah.
Are you enough? I that in the studio? Yeah. Location.
Can we go to outside and notice the Perdana University name so for photo session? Now? Outside. With the Perdana University signboard there.
Yeah. We'll have a photo session outside where we can see Perdana University signboard.
Yep.
Thank you. ya?
Tak, siap ni komplain apa. Dia tengok kat website, sesenyap pada tidak. Bila OD tu memang macam kadang macam tu dalam kanya.
Tak, dia orang tutup.
Kalau ni kena tutup sebab nak buka tu kan? Belakang ni tak ada buka. Dia buka ke tadi buka kan?
Dia one row.
Oh, kalau kat sini habis dah. Tak
ada
apa lah.
Kenapa dia gelap ke apa?
Saya tengok. Tapi tak adalah gelap. Apa pun dia nampak je. Muka Dr. Kevin tu nampak je lah.
Sana dia. Ada lampu.
Kalau slide pun tak ada masalah.
Kita
yang pening nak dengar dia cakap kan. Kita bukan nak bagi dengar dia orang nampak benda ni kan. Salam lah biarlah. Itu pun meja lebih. Bila kita tolong buat benda-benda ni. Kata
kita
ni
buat
benda-benda ni.
Eh, silakan.
Siapa komplain? Siaran. Sekian lagi. Lepas ni perasaan PD kan?
Life,
life. Apa yang life? Apa yang
life? Eren, dengar tak Eren? Tak boleh, tak boleh.
Ya.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will be starting your next session very soon. Could you take your seat, please? It would be good if everyone can go to the front to fill up the front rows. The next session will be about integrated approach to teaching healthcare ethics. This will be delivered by Professor Zabidi Hussein. He's really no stranger to most of us in this room. He's a former dean in USM School of Medical Sciences. He's been there in the Malaysian Medical Council for some time. He himself is a professor of pediatrics and he's been championing bioethics in Universiti Sains Malaysia together with many of us in USM. So without further ado, I call upon Prof. Zabidi Hussein.
Thank you for having me in this workshop. Following the success of the previous workshop we had in 2013. Yeah? So what I'm going to do this morning, folks, is to touch this subject and maybe at the end of this talk, way how ethics could be taught to medical students. And in some ways, many of the things that I'm mentioning during this talk is a continuation of what Professor Morgan said earlier. You know, the very powerful role of the power of role modeling and how role modeling can be set up, not only in a classroom setting, but maybe in the field where action happens. And you will see pictures of what happened and how we can use those opportunities to teach ethics to our students. In some ways, it's a personal journey and a narrative of personal journey, because throughout my 25 years, the university has been very kind in allowing me to participate in events where disasters throughout the world. I remember going to Kosovo after the war, Aceh during the earthquake, events, and bring students with me, some students with me, and participate in these events convinced me that the teaching of ethics shouldn't be in a classroom. You learn a lot more about humanity when you're there on the field with the students, rather than having them memorize a whole textbook of humanities. Yeah? So that is the gist of what I'm going to talk about. The scope of my talk is going to continue what the WSO has been championing, the interprofessional education. And I think although many people speak about the need to have interprofessional education, in reality, we don't do much of that. And while interprofessional education to some of us may mean that professionals like us sit together, Karen being a psychologist, somebody else being a sociologist, anthropologist, sitting with the medics, I'm going to propose to you that the same arrangement should be done by students. Students of anthropology, students of sociology, students of medicine and of engineering, of medical architect, actors should be in the room discussing problem-based learning about human and so on. Because I think the interprofessional learning should lead to a workforce-ready collaboration, but that will come to later. And I think if we really are serious in that kind of interprofessional education, I think we could challenge the classical and traditional methods of teaching ethics which we do now. Right? I think we can easily challenge those because that may not fit into the scheme of interprofessional education. I will go on to say about what are the core elements of ethics needed by physicians. You know, I'm a physician, I'm a pediatrician. What are the core ethical values I need to have? And what are the values that my students need to have to be a good doctor, to be a compassionate doctor? Because all these core elements are those that will lead to attitude formation and a nurturing, I'm sorry about the spelling, nurturing of ethics throughout the years of training. And I'm going to talk a bit about experiential learning. Not theoretical learning, but experiential learning on the field, all right? And those will lead to very powerful attitude formation and nurturing of ethical behavior, all right? I'm going to touch also, I have two slides on this, continuation of what Professor Morgan was saying earlier this morning, that yesterday there was a publication on altruism and where exactly in the brain altruism centered lies. Prior to this, people were talking about empathy, a centers of empathy, you know, with the functional MRI. They can actually map exactly where the center of empathy is. And the center of empathy and center of altruism will light up more and more as you expose students to situations that require empathy and altruistic behavior. So all these centers, the parts of the brain that you have, can actually be stimulated in a real-time environment. Hence, our teaching of ethics should do that rather than just giving them lectures upon lectures and PBL upon PBL. So those will be the scope, and I will end up my talk by giving a proposal on such a, an interprofessional education. This is in press, it's going to be published in December, impact factor 5 or something like that. We are undergoing a project now in USM where we take this interprofessional collaborative practice competency from Malaysian's medical professional perspective. This is a study done by Rohanis Roslan to really prove again that the future and the way forward is that kind of collaboration. And again, the Bristol Royal Infirmary inquiry, one of the key features mentioned in there was the health professionals should have more opportunities to complement one another in terms of the skills. You know? Because it is well known that doctors, medical doctors, sometimes assume when you have a doctor in the parent of a teachers association, for example, that doctor is likely to be the president of the parent teachers group, yeah? Because there is some inherent dominance, you know, medical dominance that permeates through the group, you know? And that kind of dominance led to disasters, actually, because they were not willing to be corrected by others. And that was one of the recommendations, because the Bristol Royal Inquiry said that there must be others who complement these doctors, you know. Others may not be people with a CGPA of 4.8 or whatever, but they may be people who have the right values to make that correction. You know? Because without that, that led to the disaster that we know happened in the 1990s. So that's a very, very firm recommendation from the prestigious committee that looked into this tragedy. You know? Because clearly it's difficult for individual professionals to address all of the people. You know? I'm conscious throughout my 25 years in USM of trying to put together professionals from nutrition, from diets, from medical architectures into medicine. Because I think this really should be the way forward. And WHO does mention about this role of IPE to produce a collaborative ready workforce. This is a term which is coming in now, a collaborative ready workforce where students can learn, right? Well, just briefly about the current state, we are more familiar with what we do now because we have a very comprehensive ethics curriculum in place. We have books. In some universities, there are ethics intensive course for students, you know, consisting of lectures, PBL, and videos, and films, and movies. Numerous textbook references on ethics, reflective diaries, lectures and tutorials, and so on. We have videos and we show our students on how to behave and how to communicate. In some universities, they name the modules as human behavior, development and aging, hoping that by understanding behavior, development and aging, you become ethical. In USM, we have the community and case studies. These are all largely theoretical. It's convenient for lecturers, for the deans, for the medical faculty to do it because it can withstand the test, you know, that it is easily examinable. You get high marks in these two, are assumed to be to have acquired ethical. Listen to what I'm going to present to you cases from the MMC, ethical people who have problems with the ethics in MMC. Many of them do not have problems passing the exam. Many of them have passed the exam, including the ethics modules, all right? And so on, but still people make mistakes because of other reasons. Okay. So coming then to a perspective of a physician, a pediatrician like me, I am forced to ask myself what really is the essential ethical behavior that's needed of me. We will hear more about this mercy because this is now ongoing in USM. Prof. Azwani will talk to you about this particular assessment of this approach. When we force ourselves to see what are really the core values needed of a doctor and a student of medicine, we think that we cannot talk ethics without the competency of M, the medical issues, you know, the diagnosis and treatment of disease. You know, if this is not up to date, you can be the most compassionate doctor on earth. but you get the diagnosis wrong, that's not ethical, all right? So I think that the first part is that competency, the core competency. But second, this is my favorite, empathy. I think if we have empathy, a lot of the world problems can be solved, right? We can understand other people's perspective. And I think this is big. In fact, there is a society called the Empathy Society, you know, being launched by various people. Gomez is one of them, saying that whatever your background, culture, and so on, if people are equipped with empathy, alone maybe, that should be enough, you know, to ensure at least you don't go on and harm people and so on. Empathy is very powerful. Then respect, all right? Respect of one's different opinion, respect of someone's form of dressing, for example, gender, sexual orientation, just respect. You may not agree with them, but just by showing some respect to them, I think it's very, very important for a doctor. Ability to communicate, and the C can also stand for compassionate, being compassionate, and ability to understand patients in terms of their insight. So in USM, we use this eight memoir to tell our students, these are the five core values that we should have. And having this would at least ensure us teachers that you will go out as an ethical doctor, as an ethical medical student. And we put it together as mercy, all right? And you are a merciful doctor, hopefully, right? Okay, so imagine, you know, imagine we see a doctor with who have these values, who has these values, ability to have the accurate diagnosis and up-to-date treatment, understand our feelings, respect the differences, although the patient and the doctor may have different sets of value. I think if a doctor or medical student has all these qualities, then I think there's less likelihood of you suing those doctors, even though he makes a mistake, all right? So I think we have been doing this now for almost more than 2 years, and some data is coming in now to say that this kind of aid memoir for students actually helped them to undergo an ethical assessment and ethical perspective. About people, Batson deals with people. Clearly, people are of different culture, we need to understand that. Behavior, belief, and so forth. Language, and so on. Because sickness and health and reaction to sickness are closely linked to all these values. So we need to understand that. So it means that the theoretical part of ethics teaching must have sound background on theory of human behavior. There is no, you know, excuse on that, right? We must understand the theory of how people behave during health and sickness. We must understand what are the key features in effective communication, knowledge of culture of the population, what are the likes and dislikes of certain population. That is a must know for our medical students, some legal issues. So all these things can be done in a theoretical manner, not by doctors necessarily. Of course, people use sociologists, psychologists, maybe the media and communication specialists, you know, and the medical doctor, or anthropologists, lawyers. All these are interprofessional. They can provide us with a very strong fundamentals on all these issues, right? That's the theoretical part of ethical teaching. But the ethical teaching that can mold behavior of students, that can form their attitude, are things that what Professor Morgan mentioned this morning. You know, how they silently watch you, what you do and how you behave, either in public or in private. Okay, this is something that that's something which is proven to be the case. The conduct of the teachers, you know, the role model has been said this morning. Perhaps the environment of an administrative system in place, you know, when you're put in a situation that there's not enough of everything, it's really, really challenging to be ethical and doing things in an ethical manner. So all of these things are behaviors and environment that will shape their thinking. And they will reflect on that and they will tell stories on that. What are the best setting of this? If we agree, and I hope that you agree with this, that this is a very powerful, the community is the best laboratory for teaching ethics, that's the best setting for ethics teaching, where do we go? So we go on experiential level. We must put enough emphasis on experiential learning, which is learning through experience. learning through getting the students right in the field when there is a major earthquake. The Minister of Education now talks about flexible learning. The flexible learning should go one step further now, not just flexibility in terms of credit transfer and so on. But when you're doing med pediatrics posting for 6 weeks, on week four, major disasters happen in somewhere involving children, you stop the teaching and go be the teacher there. That's my proposal. Most deans will say, no, not possible. No exam coming up in 2 weeks' time. I said, let's do really flexible teaching. Right? Because that's the best setting now for anything pediatrics, whether it's pediatric medical, psychology, environment, that's the best setting for our experiencing this. Because it's learning through reflection and doing. To the zoo and learning about interacting with the zoo environment, as opposed to reading about animals in a book. This is the, by definition, the experiential learning. I mentioned to you earlier, before I go on to show to you a real life environment of how things happen on the field, these are the empathy centers. Centers that actually light up when people are being put in an environment that requires empathy. They're put in an environment where they just hear somebody screaming for help, in a really desperate scream. Then at the same time, they scan the brain. And they see that in the brain, there are certain specific areas that light up, you know. That is the empathy center. We want that empathy center to keep lighting up by exposing them to situations where empathy is required, right? And there's nothing short of that except exposing them to that environment. And because we know also that psychopaths do not have the centers that lit up. They may have been brought in an environment where there maybe it was genetics, but maybe there wasn't enough to stimulate that situation where empathy became the rule. So we know clearly that by exposing our students, by exposing someone who's in training, by exposing our children to such an environment, we know physical changes actually happen in the brain. Centers get lit up. And I think this is a very powerful thing to say that we really need to go on to that. This is a very recent, it was 2 days ago, where in addition to empathy centers, we are now mapping altruistic behavior and how behaving in that environment causes certain areas of the brain to be light up. You know, this is really an advancement because of the functional MRI that we are now have in place. Let me just sidetrack a bit, all right? I feel that medical schools are alien. I feel that our lecturers and teachers and role models, we are overworked, outnumbered maybe, huh? Because we are put under extreme pressure to publish. And all that good for the profession. For the medical profession, because from experience I know that when there is when the rewards are given, papers, publication of papers, and the reward and rewards are withdrawn from those who want to stay in an institution where they want to continuously be rewarded, will actually avoid the thing that they should really be doing, which is staying with the students, working with the students, and performing the role model, right? And their approach to medical education becomes non-imaginative. The role modeling suffers, and that leads to a very tired and uninspired students. Okay? So when we hear now in Malaysia, there are issues about residents are making gross, unimaginable errors. The soldiers in the army will say that there are no bad soldiers. In the army, you say that there are no bad soldiers. You be an enemy. There are no bad soldiers. There are bad generals, but there are no bad soldiers. So I think this again emphasizes that we must not just bang our students, you know, or scold them for being uninspired, but the inspiration actually comes from us. So we need to find a way to find the right setting to bring back their altruism and their excitement of medicine. And there are many opportunities to do that. Take them away from the war. And expose them to real environment. Not just in elective. You know, now we have elective posting where you can go or opt not to go. Make it a compulsory. Go out there in the community and talk to these kids. You know, bring them and talk and make them meet with kids with SMA, and many of them wondering about getting married. You know, and these are real happenings. You know, these SMA girls, they are 23, 24 years old, talking about, you know, reproduction, for example. The students have to be exposed to that and be familiar with these issues. Okay. Make them do sabbatical, which I have done. Sabbatical with the Bobo. I spent 3 months going around with a shaman, you know, picking herbs in the jungle and understanding how he communicates with the patients and how this Bobo gain confidence from patients. I know how they talk. They're not like us doctors who just, you know, give orders and expect obedience. No, you know. So make these students, create environments for them to do that. And I think we, in the position of leadership, should be able to do that. Make them visit children in your home, right? Make them go on hospital field. Unfortunately, at that time, I wouldn't want to bring students there. But just seeing that mother who walked a long way to this field hospital and with a baby who's, by all intents and purpose, we couldn't cure him because this is a hypoxic birth and delivery that has produced that. But that you know, that hope on her face should be observed by students, you know, and should make them feel that, you know, when they're a houseman, they have to rush when an asphyxiated baby is born. They have to rush because they see that. They see a mother who's with all the hope, walking all the way to see a doctor, hoping that this doctor from Malaysia can do something about it. They need to understand the dynamics, right? And there are other situations. This is in Taiwan, the palliative care group in Taiwan. This is it's best for water now. This is a big earthquake in Aceh, and there was some students who came with us. And we didn't realize when we came back from this experience, we were very grumpy. We just left, you know. And my psychiatrist says that is PTSD. That was PTSD, post-traumatic depression. Because I thought I was strong enough to see that, deal with it, and come home. But when we went home, the images, you know, the memories linger on, and that shapes your thinking and so on. So for some time after that visit, psychiatrist, yeah, that was PTSD. You know? I said, nah, it wasn't. It was, right? Okay. So, that was like reading a big major textbook on humanity, right? How to deal with other people, how to work in a group. And I wish more students could come because that doctor is digging a well, together with a doctor digging a well, digging a, you know, making, he's an ENT specialist, right? We went there with the Mercy, with a group of Mercy Malaysia group. The doctor felt that we were going there to give medication, you see. But no, you're not required to give medication. There's nobody with flu. People have no water, right? So we had to dig wells and in the process understand how that is done and so on, right? This would have been unthinkable, that scenario, you know. In a setting where you are required to do one thing, which is to help those people, to help these kids, you know, you forget differences. And I wish more students would come with me and watch that. Right? And watch how, in an environment of interprofessional relationship, you can work together with people, somebody who may not be luxury to work with you in another setting. So I think this is a very powerful message, you know. And students with us on that trip and off and so on. They should see the life because they were in a boarding school. They were in a boarding school, but the parents stayed in the island, so the island was wiped out. But being in a boarding school, they were safe, all right? And people sent them clothes and so on, and they were making mockery of all this. You know, they say that, you know, these are clothes which are meant to be discarded, all right? And you send them as though you are helping them, okay? And people send them bags and bags and shiploads of dried noodle. They're sick of dried noodle. Students should see that. You know, students should see that and learn from that, right? The other more recent disaster, unfortunately, was the flood, the big flood in Malaysia 2014. And again, there were many students involved there, many students involved there. And I can narratives to say, and I bet you these students will have better perspective of people, you know, and more than what the books can tell you, all right? They will tell you that, you know, because there was no, because all there was flood water, they had to break that pipe, you know, and bring in rainwater. There were a group of students with us in that area, and at the time I was with the army at the time. Okay, we tell them to be entrepreneurial again, sell something and so on. Look at this guy, all right? He had a weighing scale with him. And if you want to jump on that weighing scale, pay him 10 cents. Right? So that's entrepreneurial. And you can learn a lot from these kids, you know. One of them, this one, you know, I said, what do you want, you know, if you go back home and after this disaster, what would you want? And he wanted a blue tent. I don't know why he wanted a blue tent, but he said, even when you go back to Malaysia, please remember bringing a blue tent. I couldn't meet his wishes, but I think it's very, very enlightening talking to these kids and working with people from other, you know, from Canada and so on. And relying on these folks, you know, the pilots and so on. And so I think observing interprofessional relationship and how to work in that will have a very powerful effect on students' behavior. Of course, they will have the 14 flood. You see there's a medical student there. This is from the lab, He's a chief of Mercy Malaysia. He looks like orang asli kan, this guy. Yeah. He didn't look like an orang asli after the haircut. That's my son. This is from A, from A University. We were there together, from A University, Sumatran, China, and so on. So, exposing medics, medical students, doctors to that, I think will reduce this. Will reduce that perception of medical dominance, and that will hopefully bring down the self-aggrandizing hyperbole that we have with some people. You know, that they can cure or bring life and death, and use that. It will make the medical dominance less. The medical setting. We want people with humility, people who can accept differences and so on. And I think this is not just the case of medics, you know, it can be applicable to other forms of professions as well. So I think we need to have a theory, of course. We need to have a theory of human, like I said earlier, legal issues, that has to be theoretical. But the experiential learning at first opportunity must be there at first opportunity and not just an elective or go if you can. We must make enough room in our curriculum to allow for that, right? Allow for that kind of flexibility. Maybe we should bring students from various disciplines, you know? Or we should bring students from medical, nursing, engineering, food science, dietitian, philosophy, although they come with different entry requirement, but in certain settings they are together in the same group, media help. And discussing things of the same interest. Flexible learning, and maybe capping all that, we probably have an annual students' conference, you know, to relate these experiences with particular issues on ethical emphasis. And I think, I mean, people have done this already, you know, some groups have gone out to do things, but I think we should try to make this as formal as possible, because there's no other way in my mind. To produce an ethical doctor, except by having them go through a real experiential learning, like what I've said earlier. Conclusion then, ladies and gentlemen, simple message that interprofessional education is not just profession, your VC. Make sure you create a flexible learning environment, because higher education is a nurturing of character. It's a nurturing of character. Higher education is the best platform to provide that kind of nurturing of character and attitude, and I think that can be done from the way that I've said it. Thank you very much for.
Thank you, Prof. Zazili, for challenging us with this new idea, as always. I think we still have quite some time until the next session. Taking questions here.
We bring our students out, because some of us are also doing that. But over in my place, we have started doing, for the final year, for the ethics exams, we do not have, we have got one exam paper where we sit down, but there is one whereby the students have to actually present cases that they have got when they go around in the field. I give them a period from the time that they come to the medical school from year 3, and at the end of the year 5, they are supposed to present a case that they have got from anywhere that they have been. So, and most of them actually got the cases from the wards. So the last professional, the last professional exam when we had our ethics component, 35 people presented cases, and out of the 35 cases that they presented, half of it was showing doctors doing the wrong things. So it was, so it was actually a big issue that came out. So it's not necessarily just to go for during disasters. Like in my university, it's very common for us to go anyway, because for Perkara, we went actually, for the whole our medical faculty, because we're in the defense university, so the battalion was actually under us. So we just went with them. But the thing was that we also found that by doing this stuff, where they go around in the world and find for them, for themselves, observe and get the cases, lo and behold, we're seeing that we ourselves are role modeling the wrong thing. Inside the treatment room, their children, because the they were caught during at night, so they brought the children to the room. So we had all those funny things happening. And in the end, we're editing one more thing, say that next time when you see, can you try and respond by actually telling somebody about it or talk to that person about it? Because we need to intervene, when something like that happens. Some of them are really crazy and very dangerous things that the senior doctors are doing. Okay? Mark my words, it's the senior doctors are doing. It's not the junior or anything like that, it's the senior's one. So I think I actually when I invented the ethics for my city, I found that when I did it this way, the students were actually telling me, oh, we have to be very careful. We actually really have to think and not just follow the seniors. So this is good. Thank you very much.
Changing the behavior of the individual in terms of virtue is something that is doable on the level of the individual. My concern is what about these democratic deficits, for instance, systems that, insofar as there are injustices in the structures, in the hierarchy, we can talk, for instance, of bureaucratic systems and the inability of people to make the right judgments because they are under the domain of those people who have control over them. So what do you think, most importantly, should be done so that we can professionalize more the bureaucracy and all of these things in order for people, especially in the rural areas, to have access to good and quality healthcare?
I think that involves a key strategy of how to influence change. You know, this is a big subject, and how you see something wrong, how do you make the change, And there are various steps, how to make a change. We don't have time to go through all of that. But I think we should give that particular skills to our students, because a student who see that there's something wrong, if he just, blurt it out and say, hey, why are you doing the wrong thing? Surely that's not the right thing he should have, So I think they're one of the elements of the fundamental change with time and with patience and diplomacy. So I think this is a separate issue, which I think should be one of the essentials, essential skills, in addition to how to communicate, influencing change would be another. I agree with you. That's a separate skill, very, very important skill.
Do you want to comment a question? A comment for community or event? I think that's probably, I'm not sure which one is enough, but that depends. The occurrence in the community, how they observe into the community rather than the event itself, how big the event. You mentioned about go somewhere and then see. I don't think it's really necessary if they go without learning, without I'm thinking that's what we did, probably enough, but probably we need to see we can improve further in terms of
guidance,
digest more. But the main question I want to ask the attitude and empathy, that I'm not sure whether is it an important factor from the experience. We thought attitude is a main problem that we cannot change students. So that I'm asking you, do you think that's...
Can we change attitude?
Can we teach ethic or their concern is a difference? You know, some students, I mean, medical student is not came to the university for to be a doctor, sometimes for something else, but it's forcing by the parents. So it's not easy to teach ethic, and then you can teach in theory and then pass the exam, but when they're houseman or work letter, they are different doctors.
I give you an example of a twin medical student, you know, from Penang. These twins, you know, have never been in rural environment, they've never seen misery, they've never seen poverty. And in our program, we make them stay in the CFCS program, we make them stay in the community. Not just go for the day and come back in the evening, no, they actually stay in those houses, you know. And the twins came to see me after that. I said, this is the biggest thing that changed her attitude, she says. You know? Because she sees how difficulties people have in the community and so on. So I think it is possible. It is possible to expose people to real life experiences, you know, and change over a period of time. It may not be one event that changed people, but a series of exposures, like us, you know, after we go through a series of exposures, a certain attitude will probably change. So I think let's not despair, you know. Some people may come from a very posh environment, you know. I heard my son telling me that Form 5, was one boy in Form 5, he went to school driving BMW now, you know, and looking very, very royal in terms of look and so on. But I'm sure such student should be exposed to another environment. And it's the exposure of environments that will change people. I think I will not despair. I think we should provide any opportunities. You don't have to wait for disasters to happen, but have enough opportunities in the curriculum to make sure that that's done. Right? And I think that is, you know. And when they go out there, they don't just go out and do wild things. You know, they go out with a certain thing in mind. Another example that I can give you. There is often a hidden kind of a competition, right, between certain religious groups, right? You know, somebody from one group say that I do these things better and so on. And I can tell you a real example, you know, of how someone from a religious group went to Conakry during the disaster and went back and told me that we were so impressed with what the Suchi. Is that how you pronounce it?
The
Suchi group and how they behave, and we were so impressed. And even though this group was all the ones saying that we are the best, we give all to them, but when they saw the Buddhist group working, they said we're humbled by that. You know? So I think that is crossing the border of religious arrogance, if you like. You know? When they saw somebody doing better things, and they may not be of the same faith, you know? But they appreciate that this is much better, much more systematic. And that was a real happening in Kuala Krai. You know? So I think there's a lot of opportunities to make people learn, right, through this kind of opportunities. Yeah.
Yes, thank you for sharing your personal journey in bioethics. So you highlighted a lot of pros of experiential learning and cons also for theoretical learning. So, and this is related to what was discussed earlier. So I'm not from the medical, I'm not a medical doctor, so I may be ignorant. How difficult, what is being done to incorporate experiential learning as a core or compulsory component of so-called the curriculum, you know, to train the doctors as part of the bioethics training? What is being done, what's the status, and how can we measure? Because I think you mentioned about it's easy to measure, so we do that. Can we somehow measure these things too, so that it can be also incorporated?
In Malaysia, the system which is good at measuring is the Medical Association, the MMC. You know, they have certain prescribed weeks of clinical exposure, and that's experiential. You know? the students would have to spend 120 weeks seeing patients, you know, and by that they mean 120 weeks seeing patients in the world, right? That's standard that nobody can argue. But what I'm saying is that if we are curriculum planners, if you are people who are concerned about ethics, my view is that that standard prescribed exposure need to be supplemented with something else, you know? Need to be supplemented with something else, which is bigger and more transformative in nature. That's what I'm saying. You know? So as it is, maybe cut the curriculum. People in master's are already there in the world and doing things, being guided, of course, by the seniors, you know? So I think we should really trim the fat from our curriculum. There's so much fat in our curriculum, right? So much unnecessary issues in our curriculum. Geneticists want more and more genetics. Sorry, geneticists. But, the neurologists want more and more neurology, and so on and so forth. I think we should be able to be wise enough to say that let's trim the fat, you know, and make sure that we're producing a doctor with character. And by making sure that there's enough opportunity in the curriculum for experiential learning, not just in a ward setting, which may be artificial. It is artificial. A hospital is better than a hospital, right? Where people in the house and how they relate the sickness in their own environment. That's a better reflection of what they are. We know that kids, when they come to hospital, the developmental achievement goes down because of the hospital environment. Right? So we know that hospital environment is not the best environment for providing such an opportunity. So it means that they have to go out more than being in a hospital. Going out more where? That's the challenge for the curriculum balance.
Yes, probably
me.
My question is about how much bioethics content there is in the medical curriculum. Alright? So just two aspects of the course, right? Medical course. Because I mean, I think 10 years ago I was at this conference whereby we were trying to defend the